So let me ask a question, by the way. So doing things different, better than copying somebody who's already successful and just being a copycat of a successful program?
Excellent question, and the answer is yes. On both sides. Yes, you want to model what you do after successful people and take pieces and parts of what they do, and then you want to internalize it and create your own way of speaking and communicating so that you attract people that are meant to work with you and that will find value in the way that you speak and portray yourself. So great question. Thank you. And we'll come back. I'll look to save time for some questions at the end in addition, because I love those kinds of questions.
I just saw the pause.
I do appreciate that. Yeah. And so I think I've given everybody enough time to, oh, hey, we're getting, let me just put this on airplane mode so that we are going to just adapt as much as we can as we learn technology, which we still believe is our friend. Okay. Now, it's supposed to mirror my screen.
I don't know if it will if you're in airplane mode.
Just take it off that.
Okay. See, isn't this fun? We all get to learn together. Okay. Airplane. And then what I'll do instead is, there is one that's do not disturb, that one. Okay. That's what we'll do.
I think that'll work better.
Oh. We'll see.
Yeah. Now you're back up.
Everything should be PG. You guys get a sneak peek in my personal life. And AirPlay is now not behaving. So, is this the best? Is this our favorite? Well, okay then. All right, we'll just go ahead and keep adapting. I'll tell you a little bit about me and why you would want to listen to anything I have to say. I always like to know who's talking to me if they're teaching me something. So, I'm Jen Gibbs. I have a background in marketing. I have a background in real estate. I actually love working with real estate agents specifically because that's where I really got my start. And it has like a happy place in my heart when I kind of speak your language and I know the value of adding what you bring into maybe your listing presentation that you email out ahead of time, or there's certain ways that we can build your value from the side so it's not in people's face as much. And so that's what I'm excited to cover with you today. I am a mindset mentor, so I do coach and mentor people specifically on finding limiting beliefs to receiving money or their personal value. Do you feel worthy of receiving a great income for the work that you do? And so most people do have some kind of negative money messages going through their mind. We want to get those out of your way so that you can go ahead and make a great living and serve a lot of people in your real estate business. And in fact, I had been through several courses and trainings on getting your money blocks out of your way right as I came into the real estate industry. And I remember exactly where I was standing in the training room. I was standing when I made a decision. I'm going to use real estate to just plow through my money ceiling. I do not want to have, you know, my corporate full-time income be the most I ever make. I'm going to use real estate because this industry specifically is powerful enough. You can get momentum fast enough to just really break through that. And so I was intentional about, I'm leveraging what this real estate career can provide to me. And I went on to earn six figures my first year, which I never even come close. And then I thought, oh, can I do it again? And over year, building a team. And so I was able to establish a firm identity as that successful six-figure earner. And it was in large part because of some of the things I'll be teaching you today. And so I'm excited to be able to share that with you. And I'm hoping that some of the nuggets that you can take out can help you see and meet your goals that you have for yourself in real estate, because this is truly a career where there's plenty of abundance. And one of the keys is just making sure you can broadcast yourself confidently and powerfully and inspire that confidence from clients. And so I have a little quote from Diana Kokoska. She is one of the founders and former CEO of the largest coaching organization in the world, specifically real estate related. And her quote is, "Your business grows to the level that you do." And I'm sure you guys are familiar with this concept. If we want to level up, then we usually the ceiling that we hit is our own mindset, right? There's something that we don't want to do that we know we should do, and it's just slightly out of our comfort zone. And if you can't get yourself to go beyond that, that is your symptom of limiting beliefs. And that's where level by level, we want to clear those out, transform them so they don't keep holding you back. And so today, what we're going to kind of start and build a foundation with is that trust and confidence in yourself radiates to your potential clients. And I do have some fabulous slides. In fact, let me give you my email right now, and I'm happy to send them to you. And I spent quite a lot of time, you know, preparing, I think, images that would keep you guys awake. And so anyway, I have them for you. My email is Jen with two N's, J-E-N-N at jengibbs.co. It's not .com, it's .co, and that's on my card as well. And I have a couple of other tidbits I'm happy to email out if you just reach out. I'm happy to do that. Now, I do need to take a pause. I've got a clipboard going around. If you would print clearly your name and your license number if you know it or if you have access. And if you don't, I can look those up. But I do just want to make sure that everybody's able to get their certificate for your hour of CE. And we'll do like a check-in roll call. They require a little bit more than just the sign-in. So we'll do that a little bit later in the class. But basically, when we come along, our industry in real estate exists because before there was real estate agents, there was a lot of chaos, a lot of misunderstanding, a lot of lawsuits. It was painful. It was hard. It was scary. And there's still, you know, I mean, imagine the closing file of someone buying a home, right? It's this thick of documents. And how do you know what is going to serve you and what you don't? If you're the client, it's a very vulnerable time, and even high-powered people, very confident.
Screensaver, approaching Coy Tower with downtown San Francisco and the Bay Bridge in the background.
Fantastic. Yes, you can also sell real estate in the city. We're not specifically talking about that today, but that's a nice shop. So the idea is that people do... They need you to believe in yourself so that they can feel comfortable trusting you because they're nervous. And so what we want to do is display that confidence and belief in yourself so that they are put at ease. And let me just talk quickly about smooth transactions. You guys, I'm sure, do a lot by text. Raise your hand if you've communicated the last 2 weeks by text with a client or a potential client, right? So that's everyone. And how often can a text be misunderstood or taken more than one way? Do you have a specific example you'd like to share?
All the time. Just, you know, what was the one just the other day? Somebody sent something, and it was just like a really short reply.
Okay.
And so it made me kind of feel like, oh, okay, they don't really care about this, or they're, you know, they're a little bit upset or something about this. And no, they were just, you know, just about to start driving their kid to school or something. And so...
Okay.
Rather than not replying, they just sent a really quick, short reply and then called me about 2 hours later and everything's fine.
Okay. And prime example, how many have had something like that, right? Pretty much everyone. And prime example where your mindset could have gone down the road like, are they upset? What's going on? And then that affects other conversations you might have, you know, whether or not you pursue a deadline heavily or you back off, you know, some of these kinds of things. And so just knowing and being aware that your mindset can shape your transaction is very key. Another instance might be, you know, if you have an appraisal that comes in and it's a little bit off, and just how you're able to, if you're in that solution mindset, you can go ahead and communicate what needs to be communicated with the idea like, hey, we're going to fix this, you know, it's going to work out for everyone. Or it can become chaos and drama, and I'm sure you've seen situations like that. And so just realizing that your own perception and your view of the situation can really affect your transaction is very powerful. So I just like to call awareness to that. So I don't know how many of you are familiar with the concept of energy. Einstein talks about everything is energy, and your body is particles and mostly waves in space. Are you familiar with this? It used to be kind of like, you know, it, like a little bit of a hippie kind of a thing to do, which it still is, to talk about energy and frequency. But really, more and more recently, it's backed up by science. And so if you talk about your own personal energy field, you know, the body being electric, your energy does not stop where your body is. They can actually put sensors outside of your head and measure your thoughts. So your thoughts radiate out. It's super interesting to dive into all of that kind of energy work. But your energy literally... if you put your hand, everybody put your hands out. Okay, now I'm going to do a little experiment. So this is kind of where your energy field is. And if I get too close, I start to enter your energy space, right? And you can feel it. And unless we're really good friends and you're wanting a hug or something, you're kind of, you want to protect your space, right? And so what we want to do, start paying attention to that. It's kind of funny. It also goes up and down into the earth even. Start paying attention that your energy communicates about you. And so it's not just a one way. It's not just that you're projecting, but it's also that the people that you're going to be meeting with, these potential clients, they may not have words to describe what it is, but they get a feeling, they get a gut instinct, right? And they their subconscious mind picks up on what you're projecting. It's the silent communication that may not even have awareness on either party. But that is part of why it's so important for you to get your energy right. Because whether you know that you're projecting and broadcasting these thoughts about how you see yourself and how competent you feel, these are being communicated and the clients can tell even if they don't know what it is, right? And so we want to make sure we present you and that your energy is as strong and powerful and confidence building as possible. And so I'm glad I see a lot of heads nodding. I feel like this concept is kind of sinking in a little bit. What's important to know too, it's not just about getting excited and getting motivated and pumping yourself up, even though, has everyone seen the TED Talk by Amy Cuddy about the power poses? Okay, there. I would jot that down if you haven't seen the TED Talk by Amy Cuddy, C-U-D-D-Y. It's excellent. She talks about how your physiology, your physical self, can help change the energy and the chances of you getting a job interview and all these kind of things. She's done very scientific studies on how your body and your energy changing can affect your results. And so that's a little bit of a premise that we're working on here. You can't fake it. You can't fake it. You really have to believe that what you have is valuable and that you are competent. So if you have any questions about that, spend some time journaling. Make a list. Why am I valuable? Why am I helpful? How do I serve people? And we'll go a little bit more into detail as we go, but I just want you to realize that it needs to be genuine. Your energy can't fake for you. It will tell on you, and actually your body even will tattle on you. Your body language, I'm sure you guys are familiar with the concept, even a small move in a muscle in your face or a hesitation when you're answering a question or a shift in your seat as you're at the listing table. All those things can give you away if you don't really feel like you are the best person for the job. And so it has to start with you really believing in yourself that you are that best person, that they are going to be better served by you than anybody else. And you're the one taking time sitting with them. And so just let's make sure we get all the pieces together. And then the last part I want to cover on that part is coming from service. So if we all want to make a living, we all want to do well for our families, provide. And so we're in this not to volunteer, but to create business, right? And create a lifestyle for ourselves. And another quote I like by Gary Keller actually is the reason for business is to fund the perfect life. That's what we want. We're trying to support our families. And yet if we become too focused on what the transaction is going to net us, if we're going in and just really kind of doing math, like I'm going to take this and I'm going to go on this vacation or do whatever, if it becomes more about us than about serving and helping the client, they also will feel that shift in energy. And in fact, I know of a situation where the paperwork was almost signed for the listing and the agent was like, okay, it's in the bag. All right, doing $400,000 at 3%, 12 grand, sweet. And there was just a shift in the energy that the client could sense. And the one last blank did not get signed because it just felt like a red flag. Something was different. They couldn't explain what, but they just didn't feel as good about it. And so while it's okay to have goals and it's good to think abundance and you should be compensated for the work that you do, it's important to make first and foremost that service to the client and to keep that forefront because that will speak through your energy as well. Make sense? Mm-hmm. Okay, excellent. I'm on my way through my fantastic slides that you'll see one day. The first important person and the most important person to sell on your skills is yourself. It's also going to be the most profitable transaction that you ever have. And so definitely, I think I've made this point to make sure you have that in place. And what we want to do first is not focus maybe on the real estate part, but just back up to the 10,000 foot view and say, okay, I'm in a role of a salesperson and that's okay. A lot of people have negative associations with people in the sales industry. They've had a bad experience. They felt pressured. They have been in a situation where maybe an amateur salesperson, I like to refer them, somebody that just used kind of old school tactics, didn't listen, created a negative experience. You know, if that's what we associate with being in the field of sales, then yeah, it's going to go against our values. We're going to say, we don't want to pressure people. I don't want to sell people. That feels icky. And what we want to do is realize that just because you've encountered that situation before, that's not how a professional would do it. Because I'm sure you've also had the experience where you've gone in and someone has taken 5-star care of you and they met all your needs, they listened and they helped you solve your problem. And you're like, yes, all day long, thank you for helping me. And you would be happy to, you know, sign the paper, enter the contract, because that was going to be something that felt good and experience. And so what I want to have you do is really focus on that positive experience and be able to say, yes, I'm in sales. That's what I do. I'm really good at it. I serve my clients and that's how I make a living. And so first is owning that I am in sales and that is okay. And I'm proud of it. And a great resource that I love for this is a book by Grant Cardone. It's called Sell or Be Sold. And I'm just giving you guys a few tools that I've used that have helped me. If you want to dive a little deeper on this, I think it's a fantastic resource. And he really goes deep on helping you just understand that what you're doing is very valuable in the economy. Nothing moves until somebody sells something. If you think about it, anybody that has a job in manufacturing or any kind of, you know, a factory or marketing or online right now, right? Like if you just think of all the industries that are connected to someone selling something, it's a huge piece of our economy. And so the whole world depends on you just really getting good with yourself and helping those transactions move through. So just realize that we want to wrap our head around being in sales and then also that you are good at selling real estate. And you already sell all the time. Does everybody acknowledge that they're in sales already? Like if you want to go to dinner and your spouse or your date wants to go somewhere else, you become suddenly a very good salesperson at promoting the virtues and the benefits and how it's going to feel when you go to the place that you want to go or the movie, you know, or if you have children, selling them on doing the homework or eating the veggies. You know, I'm sure you can identify in your life several areas that you are already very good at sales. So just realize you're in sales. That's okay. That's great. That's where the most opportunity really is and that you're already good at it. So let's get those couple things out of the way and associate yourself with positive sales experiences, because when you walk in, you are the hero. You are the one that's going to take away the pain and the scariness and not let them enter into some kind of agreement that's going to sign away a bunch of something that they didn't intend to do, right? You're their advocate. You guys are familiar with that. And so see yourself, I don't know if you want to imagine yourself walking into the listing appointment with the cape flowing behind you as the super person, right? But you really are there to help prevent them from having any kinds of negative situations in the transaction. So what could happen if you don't show up? If you don't find the confidence to first book the appointment, whether it's on, you know, in person or on the phone, you know, if you don't show up, what is going to happen? Let's just get some feedback from you guys. How is their life going to be not as good if you don't show up and help them with their transaction? You're nodding?
For a listing appointment?
Sure. Let's say for a listing appointment.
Well, they got like a 60 to 70% chance of getting a crummy listing agent.
It's true. That's a big deal, right? If we don't believe in ourselves enough to really go after those listings, who knows who they're going to end up with?
And then they're going to have a bad experience, and then they're not going to want to work with an agent the next time.
Yeah, and when we kind of gloss over bad experience, and we all have done enough transactions that I'm sure yours are flow pretty smoothly. You know how to resolve issues. But a bad experience to someone that's trying to sell their house, they have the stress, they might have time pressure of having to have it sold by a certain time and move. There's crying, there's fighting, there's like so much stress. When you talk about having a bad experience, sometimes we're a little disconnected from that because it's our job to work them through all that. But it's sleepless nights, it's stress, it's not fun. And so you're needed to show up in a big way.
Does that mean you're added to the list, bartender, hairdresser, and then real estate agent?
Therapist slash real estate agent. Yeah, yeah. And that's another part of what we do is take that emotional, that the fears, you know, we talked about your perception of the transaction can affect the transaction, right? That's actually, it's very interesting if you look at some of the scientific research that if two scientists are looking at the same molecule under the microscope, it actually can change based on the person that's looking at it. That's, we're not going to go too far down that road. You may be familiar with some of those studies. And so obviously it follows that your transaction could change based on who's looking at it, right? And so if a client is looking at a situation with fear and it's going to, you know, something's going to go wrong, it's all going to fall out, you can see how that would change what could come about during the course of the transaction. So that's where your stability and what you bring is helping manage those emotions. Sometimes it's not even between buyer and seller. Sometimes it's just between, you know, the two sellers trying to get along and decide, you know, are we taking the fridge, are we not? And then if there's a situation, have you come in and be the voice of reason and calmness. And so, yeah, these are all the reasons that you are needed in the transaction. And I would invite you to pause for a second and see if any of these things we've talked about should go on your list on the back of your page of how you contribute to a transaction, because I think there may be some that you hadn't considered before, the value that you bring to the transaction. All right, I have a fun story about gold bars. And just to go another quick second on this, imagine if you're at the mall and you need 10 bucks and you're walking up to somebody and you're like, I just need 10 bucks. Have you got 10 bucks? It's awkward, it feels icky, and we don't want to do it. And no disrespect to anyone that's in a situation where they might need to ask something like that. But in our role play, yeah. And why? Why? Because we have a desire to reciprocate. We feel it's right for energy to be exchanged, a give and receive, right? Not a give and take. A give and receive. And so if you walk up to someone and you feel like you're taking and you're asking, maybe begging, it feels yucky to you and it's going to feel yucky to them. And so that's why if you're entering into, say, a buyer consult and you're like, I really need you to sign the contract with me and I got to pay my mortgage. You know, if that's where you're coming from, it feels icky to you and that energy talks to them when you don't say a word. And so the difference is, instead of feeling like you're in that asking mode, imagine if you were going with your radio flyer red wagon and you had it stacked full of big old gold bars and you're walking through the mall and you've got something and you're offering it. So I reach in my wagon, would you like a gold bar? It's just for you. If you want it, you can go buy stuff. You can, you know, you can give it to somebody else, whatever. Do you want a gold bar?
Yeah.
Okay, there you go. Okay. Did you want one? Do you want a gold bar?
No, I'm good, thanks.
Okay, there, you know, there's a lot of value in here and you can do a lot of stuff with it. It gives you tons of options. Are you sure?
No, it's a gold bar.
Okay. Okay, so what I want to point out there is, does the value of the gold bar change whether they accept it or not?
No.
No. It's still a gold bar, right? And just because someone doesn't need it or doesn't want to, you know, accept the benefits into their life, it doesn't reflect on me who's handing out the gold bar, right? And so that's kind of how it is when you're in your own presentation too, is some people will see what you offer as valuable and say, yeah, I want to have that in my life. Let's go ahead and move forward. And some others, it may not be the right fit. It may not be the right vibe, the right timing. For whatever reason, some people just choose to not accept our offering of something that's very valuable. But it doesn't change what we have offered, and it doesn't reflect anything on us as the person doing the offering. Does that make sense? That analogy, that particular story has helped me in detaching from the outcome, right? Like, I'm here to help. I know what I have would serve and help them. And if they're not ready, then that's okay. And I can keep moving without getting stuck on it. So there's that. All right. I'm going to go through a couple of these. They really are fun slides. One day. see how fun they were. Okay, so what I want to do is skip to your impressive bio. And I let's see. Oh, thank you. I'm going to go ahead and grab a sheet from back here. What is the point of your real estate bio? So early on, actually before I had even done my first transaction, I was encountering a situation where there was a potential for a lot of listings altogether. It was a brand new development, and I wanted to compete for the chance to list about a dozen properties. And so I went, and I'd never closed a transaction before, but I was confident, and I went in there, and I said, oh, I'd like the chance to, you know, to market your properties, and I was really hoping they would not ask me how long I've been in real estate, because I was confident, but I did not have a track record. And so as we went about it, they said, well, okay, you portray yourself well. And so we'd like you to present your marketing plan and send your bio over. I'm like, sure. And then I go home, I'm like, what? Bio? I didn't have a bio. Let's put together a bio. And so I did. And that actual exercise, I was thinking I had brought mine here. And it didn't print on. That exercise was actually really good for me. And so do keep your scratch paper open. I want you to think about some things that you can include in your bio. How many, raise your hand if you've been in the real estate industry more than 1 year. More than 1 year. Okay, good. And so you've probably got some great data, some great evidence that you are a good agent. And what we want to do is compile those and think about creating. I would encourage you as homework to go ahead and create a one-page bio. Here's your picture and your name at the top. And in this year, here's what I accomplished in real estate. And then the next year, I did this. And the next year, I did that. And what we're doing are two things. One, we're helping you sell yourself on what you do, on your own service, right? Because we want to make a big, giant stack of reasons why they are better off with you than anybody else. Because you have to do that first, right? We've got to sell you first. That's going to make you more money than anything. And so start thinking about what have you done in the industry. And please do include statistics. So if you close X percent of listings that you bring to the table, to the marketplace, that, you know, maybe that's 97%, maybe that's, you know, whatever that number is for you. Go out and get some statistics. Now, I'm more about give me the bullet points, I'm going to get it done, and I don't like to take as much time for the data, but there are some people that heavily weigh the data, and actually having data and statistics on your own numbers will, it's considered more credible, more factual, and it builds more credibility. So even though I would say, for the vast majority of agents, it's not your go-to to go in and look at the statistics and compare yourself, you know, to the marketplace versus others. There's, you know, there's a small group of people that really are analytical that way in nature. But for most of us, we want to either get the job done or we're going to build rapport. We're going to have a great time. We're going to help some people. And so for neither of those categories, statistics is your go-to. So take some time. And if you don't love the statistics that you find about yourself, you know, compared to no service brokerages, compared to maybe you are going to group yourself together with the brokerage as a whole. Okay, what does Presidio look like compared to other brokerages? And this is who you are part of. It's part of your brand, right? It's not your brand only, but it's part of your brand. And so let's use those statistics. However we can gather and inspire confidence, we want to gather those. So you want to start by your real estate record that you have. And then I want to also have you look outside of real estate and see what other skills have you gathered in your adult life that would serve your clients. And this is where we start to really get differentiated. So, for example, fresh into college when I was 18, I signed up with a sales company, a direct selling company. And there was lots of really valuable sales training. And so I thought, you know what? Selling health and cleaning products when I was 18 doesn't really seem like it would benefit my clients in real estate. But wait, I learned about building positive relationships. I learned about connection. I learned about confidence. And so these are some of the things. So I went ahead and added on my bio. I have sales training beginning in 1991. goes way back.
Then we, in college, we started helping manage apartments, and so that, you know, there was a good rent situation for college students there. And looking back, well, you know, I did learn about working with tenants. I was collecting rent. I was resolving issues. That actually would definitely serve my clients in real estate. So let's put that in my bio. You know, what other kinds of skills that you have outside of the industry will serve you and make you differentiated and more of value to prospective clients? So take a moment here and just look. I want you to look inside of real estate and outside of the real estate industry at things that would serve your clients. Take a moment and just write down three things. I just want to get the wheels moving of what you have that would serve your clients. I'll give you about a minute. Okay, has anyone found something that surprised you that pertains to your credibility in real estate or your authority in presenting yourself in real estate? Has anyone found
outside
something
of real estate?
Outside of real estate that serves your clients that you know.
I said that I build homes for Habitat for Humanity and also with my husband's construction company. So I know a lot of building things that that most people don't know to look for. So
excellent.
That helps me a lot.
Yeah, and it also puts that human touch. I love that you've added a piece of giving back, the Habitat for Humanity piece. I like that because people like to vote with their dollars, right? They like to participate. It makes them feel good to participate in a good cause. So I would encourage you to maybe add a component like that just for the human factor because people want to support those that share their values. And so you want to let them know what your values are so that they can have that other piece of connection with you that they might not have otherwise had. Did you want to add something?
I've just been a cosmetologist for 30 some odd years.
Okay.
And so I've really had to learn to listen to people and what they're saying because we have a different terminology than they would. And so I have to decipher that. Like, are you saying this? And I've done a lot of mirroring.
Yes. Excellent. And you can see now, have you thought of these as skills that served you in your real estate business before?
No. Well, just this last week when I went to a class.
Oh, okay. Very good. Very good. Anyone else want to share something they maybe could add to their bio?
One thing I joke around with at my listings a lot I taught kindergarten for years, and I always say, if I can handle kindergarten parents, I can handle anybody.
Nice. So
true.
And it's good. I love that you're bringing a little bit of humor, but it also underscores the point. You can handle a lot going on. You can create order from chaos, and that's important in your transaction. Thank you for sharing that. Anyone else? All right. Great examples. Thank you.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So when you're writing your bio, do you include these stories? I mean, you're not just doing like bullet point stuff. How do you create that and put it into your bio?
I'm happy to send you in the email if you ask a copy of my bio, which I thought I had with me, but apparently not. And so I just do the bullet points. In 97, I did this. In 2001, I did this. And I just do a little snippet. If they want to ask me a little bit more in detail, then I'm happy to share. But I just want to give them just the short and sweet, here's why I'm qualified. And that actually is a great lead in to the next point I was going to make. Your resume, your about me, is really about them. It's really about them. They only care about you as far as what you can help them with, what you can do. Can you help them achieve their goal, which is to close a peaceful transaction successfully, right? With, and as profitably and as smoothly as possible, right? And so everything that you're presenting as part of your impressive bio, it shouldn't be, we're not telling them statistics because look how awesome I am compared to everyone else. It's like, instead, the message is, here's what I can do. I want you to know because I want you to feel comfortable that I definitely got this. I got your back and I can take care of you. And so it comes through a little bit in the language of the way maybe you'll phrase those bullet points where whether you're talking about yourself or where you're really saying, this is how I help. You see the difference. Yeah. And so let's go ahead and I'm going to tell you how to use this, but I really am excited to go into the testimonials part right before, and then this is all going to come together. And so I want to switch gears and take you into inspiring confidence by proving that you get results. And so in this day and age, it's very common for someone to like pull up your reviews or Google you and see, they want to know what do other people think. Social proof is such a big deal right now. And so we want to help your clients make a good decision always, right? And the good decision is to work with you because you're highly qualified and you care and now you're confident about broadcasting your message and letting people know this, right? And so who trusts you? People are going to want to know, is it people like me that you help? So if I'm a veteran and I need a VA situation, have you helped other veterans before? You know, is that part of your value system? Do I see a flag on your page or something, you know, to let me know that that's an area you specialize in? Or maybe is it new construction? Okay, have you helped people through new construction before? Or are you able to, you know, tell me where not to step and where to step on the path between here and getting my house done? And so you'll want to kind of pay attention to finding and cultivating testimonials that are directed to your ideal client. Who would you like to work with? Would you like to work with a lot of first-time home buyers and just do tons of transactions and help these people get their first start? Or are you more about helping luxury homeowners? So if you're in that luxury category instead, let's make sure we have testimonials that support that you are an excellent luxury agent, that you give five-star service, that the transaction was smooth and here's what my life looks like now versus the first-time homeowner. Do you see how you can focus on which kind of testimonials are going to serve you to creating that perpetual client base that you want? Do you see? So kind of keep an eye on who is trusting you and the testimonials that you do collect and provide. Are they believable? Do people feel like that they're genuine reviews? Because, you know, it's a fact. I don't think anyone in this room would do it, but there are some trumped up testimonials. And so, you know, when people are out there shopping, they want to find, is this person genuine? Are they trustworthy? And then how many are there? So if someone is looking on, you know, Zillow or Realtor.com and there's somebody with 3 reviews and somebody with 75 reviews, automatically, who do they trust more? Probably the 75. And so can you get 75 reviews if you have not had 75 transactions? You can. We are able to, again, you don't only have real estate experience. You are a person in a community that has interacted. And so if you feel like you haven't got a good start on testimonials yet, how about approach maybe some coworkers, maybe some people that you have volunteered with or worked with in the community, someone that knows your character, and just start by asking for character-based reviews. Hey, I'm going to build some, you know, a page on my website. I'm trying to really establish some social proof. Would you mind just hopping on my Facebook and writing me a review if you feel like you could recommend me? Oh, yeah, you know, I know you. We go way back. That would be so meaningful to me. And just often asking, starting with the character-based reviews, because do people want to know about your character?
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, they don't want to only know you can get the transaction done. They want to have a good experience. And so start with character, and then of course you want to pursue as many professional reviews as you can as well. And you want to build those as you go. So develop the habit of asking for the testimonials. So where could you do this? I think a lot of people feel like you have to wait till the transaction is done, and then that's part. You're shaking your head no.
I disagree. I start from the first day.
Very good. Tell us about that.
And I do it quite often. You know, even in my listing presentation and even with my buyers, I've got a card in there. You know, this is where you're giving reviews. And I like doing it up front and saying it up front, because then they already know that I'm going to give 110% from the beginning, because that's important to me, because I said it at the beginning. So, and then I kind of do it throughout the entire time, so it's never forgotten.
Very good. And how do you do it collecting reviews with that system?
How do I collect them?
Like, what percentage do people participate?
Oh, I'm at 100% right now.
100%. Everyone gets your reviews.
Yeah. Fabulous. I would never not. And then if you don't do it, like, within halfway through, I'm like, dude, aren't I pretty awesome? Like, they're like, yeah. And I'm like, well, then here's my laptop, you know?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'll take, you know, my laptop or my iPad when you're sitting in title waiting for them to go copy the stuff. I'll just be like, you know what? If you have just a minute, we're waiting if you'd like to fill out a review for me. Sometimes it may feel like pressure, but I keep it very casual and just like have fun with it. And if they do, they do, which most of the time they do if they haven't done one by then. But yeah, I encourage them.
I love it. And I love that you start at the beginning. And so your goal is to collect the review way before the transaction is done. So yeah, at the onset, I even know of one team where the team leader says, our goal is absolutely 5-star service. 4-star service is not okay. So if you at any time during the transaction feel like you are not getting 5-star service, you call me directly, the team leader of a fairly large team. And if you have not given me 5-star reviews on these 3 sites, by 2 weeks in, I'm going to be coming down on my team and seeing what they're doing wrong, because I trust that we're going to provide you that service. And so, yeah, so piggybacking off that.
Well, I think letting them know where to put those reviews too. That's my little, at the very end, I've got made these little postcards, and it's, you know, here's where you can tell me how awesome I am, you know.
I like how you say it, but I know it's a little bit of humor.
Well, you do, and you lighten it up, and that's how I am through the whole transaction, so they expect that. But I have it broken down, you know, here's where you can go for Google, here's, you know, here's my Facebook page, here's my Instagram page, here is, you know, even just my email if you want, or here's my broker's email if you want to just tell her. You know what I mean? I break it down so that they know where they can go. So
excellent.
Making sure that they're aware of where to go, because I found that at the beginning is they're just like, oh, I'd love to get one, but where do I take it? And I was like, okay, so I've got to make
and
it
so,
very clear.
Yes, and I want to point out something you just said that's super cute and fun. So you're expecting good reviews, and you prepared to receive good reviews. You've got it all on your little postcard, or you can do this on an email that you would save and copy out. And then here, just click this link and you'll be right into the Facebook. Give me a sentence or two. Yeah. And so you expect these good things. So do we see how mindset is directly affecting the way that you collect testimonials, which then increase your business, right?
Yeah.
Right. I love it. That's fantastic example. Thank you. And so starting at the beginning, and then even especially if there has become an issue that you've resolved, are you the hero? Have you just saved the day? Oh my goodness. Appraisal came in a little bit low, but I was able to talk this through with the lender, and we fix it. By the way, is now a good time for you to give me a review, right? Or, you know, they asked for these 10 things in inspection. You know, I was able to really communicate effectively that we'd be willing to do these 3. If that feels good, oh yes, oh, that 3 is much better than 10. Okay, is now a good time for you to actually, can I send you my link and you tell people about the experience you're having, right? So yeah, all opportunities throughout. Okay, and providing the links, making sure that your accounts are set up so that there is a place for them to do these reviews and so that they can be shareable. And so once in a while, you may get an opportunity to learn. We like to always do our best and always feel like we're awesome. But just make sure that you stay humble and you have ego, take a little seat outside the door. If you do read a review that says something less than ideal, we want to know that too, right? We want to genuinely know how we can improve, how we can serve at a higher level. And so just be ready and don't be thrown off by any of those. It's certainly a chance to provide a higher level of service and maybe resolve a situation or an issue that you weren't aware of. And so as much as we want to always expect the 5-star review,
be open to, you know, this is an opportunity also to raise it to a 5-star if it wasn't for whatever reason.
Can I add something to that?
Yes, please.
You don't want to just show all the good all the time, because then people start to think that it might be fake. Let's take, for example, a certain teal-colored company that none of us like. You can't find bad reviews because they have them somehow magically deleted. You can't
even
find
though
them.
Only 70% of the listings optimistically even sell.
Right.
But you don't
right.
hear about the others.
And so people are like, oh, that's a great company. It's so hard not to say the name. That's a great company. I read all their reviews. They got all the, yeah. Did you read anything bad? No, because it's nowhere on the internet.
Yeah.
You can't find it.
Very
so
good.
It's important to let people know that, yeah, you're going to do your best, but sometimes, you know, things happen.
Well, and I think that's that element of humanness, too, because I literally had a conversation yesterday, you know, when you're talking about a 4.9 stars, well, how come it's not 5? Well, you know, in real life, there's always going to be that one person that won't be happy no matter what you do. And if you let people know that, they're like, oh, yeah, no, I know that person. And so, and it does feel more legitimate, like you really are getting the cross-section of reviews that way. So, yeah, so don't get in any kinds of, you know, stressed out or focused too much if there is a less than ideal review. It really only builds your credibility more. That's a good point. Thank you. What kinds of testimonials can you collect? So, yes, online. I like to mix it up because I feel like people, they like different kinds of media and different people. Some like video, obviously a picture's worth 1,000 words, right? So if you can do the selfie or if you can have the title person take your picture at closing, those are always great. You know, if people are not comfortable with that, then I always have a review sheet available while they're making copies. Hey, would you mind just filling this out if they weren't comfortable giving me the video is the first one that I always ask for. So would you mind just telling, you know, about your experience and you give them a question that they can leave with? How did you enjoy your experience working with me in this transaction? Go. And so if you're comfortable with the video, usually they're like, oh, I don't know, my hair, I don't know. I'm just kidding. Oh, well, you know, it's totally up to you. But if you're comfortable, it would be really valuable to me if you could just say a couple sentences about your experience working with me. So I always start looking for the video testimonial first. If that's just absolutely a no-go and I can feel it, I'm paying attention to the energy, right? Because you don't want to have a good transaction all of a sudden become uncomfortable at the last minute, right? So I'm paying attention, but I do want to capture the video testimonial if I can. So if that doesn't work, maybe just a picture, okay, you know, or if not, then, you know, here is a paper. You can just write it down. And there's a beautiful thing about taking a picture of a handwritten testimonial and putting that on your website or your social or wherever you are, because who does that? Very rare now, and rare is special, like a handwritten something, right? And then, of course, obviously, the online reviews that stack up more and more evidence, right? So collect everything you can in whatever format you can, because 92% is the data that they're saying now. 92% of consumers trust recommendations over advertising. So if you've ever thought about doing any kind of advertising that you would put money into, think if you would really rather have the 92% ROI from a friend telling a friend about you. And then you're going to want to make a home for these. So is it a social media page? Do you have a spot on your website? Where can you go and direct people to it? Even if it's just a PDF. And here's where we wrap it all up together. You've got your impressive bio, right? You've got your collection of testimonials that will be growing as you implement these strategies. And so I love to include these with my marketing piece as I send out to listing appointments. Here's what we're going to be covering. Here's why I'm different. Here's some stats about me. Here's what people say about me. And it totally changes. Instead of me walking in the room and I have to establish authority, I have to completely communicate by myself why I'm good at what I do, why I can help you. Instead, they've already looked through the testimonials, the data, the marketing plan that I have, how I'm different. So I walk in and it's kind of like, here's the house and here's my questions. Is there anything else or should we just go ahead and get started? Okay. It builds your credibility for you to take the time to create these resources and to use them in your marketing pieces, and specifically in a pre-listing presentation or even just an orientation, you know, kind of a heads up if you're sending something to your buyer before a consultation. And the last thing I want to chat with you about is sideways marketing. So as you get these testimonials, you'll want to be posting them on your social pages and not just face first, like, here's Sally and she had a great transaction. More of, I was so honored that I got to help this person. It touches me so much that she would say something so nice. I just had to share this. Here's her handwritten review. Or look at what an awesome testimonial. Or I was able to, you know, resolve this issue with inspection. And I'm so glad that I have the skills and knowledge because of my 57 transactions last year that I can help this person. You see where I'm coming from, right? And so sharing this, that social piece and that proof helps other people be able to understand without you having to say that you're awesome. It helps them understand that you're awesome. Okay, we're just about there. We've got about 2 minutes left. Any questions for me as we wrap up here?
How long do you think your bio should be?
How long do I think your bio should be?
Bio.
Oh, your bio.
One page max.
Yeah, keep it to one page and bullet points. Short attention span, they say we have less than that of a goldfish, right? Less than 8 seconds. So if you think about someone skimming, all they want to know is, can they trust you? Can you help them? They want the bullets. Okay, yeah. If you can skim it easily, 5 to 8 seconds, that's going to be ideal.
Do you ever email it over before you come, or do you do it?
Absolutely. Yeah, that's part of my process is, here's how I market, here's how I'm different, here's my bio in case you want to learn about me. You know, here's some things that people say. I include a couple of different attachments, and I let them know I'll be sending you an email with attachments. Feel free to look over as much as you want. It's probably too much information, but I want you to have it because it seems like you're really smart and you do your research, right? Mm-hmm. And that's planting the seed for them. Oh, I should do my research. Let me see what she's all about. So yeah, I like to send it, you know, a day or two, maybe 3 days before. And that's also part of kind of the confirmation process. Oh yeah, we're meeting on Thursday night. Oh, that's right. Okay.
I've had people asking for references.
There you go.
So just thinking, you have a bio, it's not a bad idea to put a couple references to people that they can call.
And just calling it references instead of testimonials, it's the same thing, right? Your testimonials are people saying, yeah, I had a great transaction with Kimberly. And so it's the same thing, but calling it references, again, builds credibility. Thank you, Trisha. Anything else?
Yeah. So a big issue always comes up about I can get more money for a house, do this at a lower cost. I can't. What about the price and cost function and all of this discussion? Do you just avoid that kind of a topic, or do you customize your some kind of a tailor, some kind of a response to this so that you can play it into a positive? Or?
Absolutely. And it's kind of the elephant in the room, right? It's the one thing that might not be said or talked about that could make the difference of whether you're able to go ahead and start working with this client or not. First thing is sell yourself. You want to find 100 reasons, 200 reasons why they are going to be better off than you, and what is all the bad stuff that could happen if they're not working with you. And you take those two on the scale, and that is worth 3%. I'm going to do all of this for you. I'm not just going to fill out your documents. I'm not just going to put your house on MLS. If this situation comes up and this nasty, funky thing and this person won't cooperate, I'm totally equipped to deal with that. I'm not just here to sell your house. I'm here to provide you 5-star experience and make sure that it doesn't cost you any extra headache. I won't even tell you if issues come up, if I just resolve them. I'll tell you that I handle them, but I don't need to bother you with every little thing, you know. And so just building your own list of all the things that you can do that they don't want to mess with. You know, they're hiring you so you take away pain, right? So what is all the pain you take away and how happy are they going to be? So I would say make sure you have a super solid foundation yourself, and then the rest kind of works out. Because at a certain point, it starts to become silly to ask you questions like that because it's so obvious how much value you provide. Right? Make sense? Great question. Anything else? Okay. Thanks so much for attending. I've enjoyed my time with you.
Thank you.
I do have certificates, and I'm happy to fill them out and hand them to you as you leave if you have a couple extra minutes. If not, then just reach out and I can either leave them here or email. We'll figure out a way to get it to you. But it should appear within the next couple of days inside of your real estate account with the state of Utah. So thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. I would love it.